Here's your host, Alex Garrett.
Well, a very special guest has joined Lou Terminello and I on Terminello's Take. And Lou, why don't you introduce today's guest to the Alex Garrett Podcast Network?
It will be my pleasure, Alex. It really will be my pleasure. We have Ralph Lawler on with us, a member of the Naismith Basketball Hall of Fame, winner of the Kurt Gowdy Award in 2019. He has his star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. He just authored a book, Bingo, which details his 40 years in the NBA. And in my opinion, and I'm going to tell you, I worked with the Nets for 28 years, so he was 3 hours behind us because they started later than we did here in the East. So when my day was over, I'd go home, lay on my sofa, or lay in the bed, and I'd go up league pass package, and I had to see it, at least some of the Clipper game, to hear Ralph Lawler, in my opinion, the most influential Los Angeles Clipper in franchise history. During all those tough years, and I know Ralph is probably going to say I'm being too kind, he kept the Clipper nation together, and that is a great way to start this interview. And obviously today's a big day for the Clippers. Ralph, as you know, they pulled off that trade for Harden. They've been a contender for the last decade. So they're moving into the new arena next year. So I guess it's a new era of Clipper basketball.
Yeah, it's another new era. Number one, Lou, thank you for the kind words. I appreciate it. But this team, I felt, they had to feel they had to do something to get over the hump. They've just not been able to get as far into the playoffs as they want. They haven't reached the NBA Finals. They really fell 4 years ago when they brought in Kawhi Leonard and Paul George. They had a great chance to win a championship. But apparently those two weren't enough. And now you add Harden and you have Russell Westbrook there. You have four likely future Hall of Fame players, a couple of former MVPs, and a Finals MVP, and multiple championships. They've got all the pieces now to do this with all of these key guys in a position where they could become free agents next summer. So it's now or never. It's boom or bust. I credit Steve Ballmer, the club's owner, and all of the front office led by Lawrence Frank for giving it a shot. You only get so many shots to be a championship team in this league. As you know, it's not easy to win a game in this league, much less win a playoff series, much less win a championship. They're doing everything they can to make it happen, and I salute them for it.
Absolutely. I mean, I know the Nets did that a couple of years ago when they did the Durant, Kyrie Irving, Harden thing. You got to go for it. And your president of basketball operations is somebody that I knew very well in my Nets days. He was our coach. He was our assistant coach. And nobody worked harder than Lawrence Frank. So if you see him down the road, tell him that Lou Terminello sends his best. He is a wonderful basketball guy, and he's a good person.
Yep.
Rob, I got to ask you, when you know, the Clippers have been on the rise here the last few years, and obviously in the 40 years, but when you started to see them really have that turnaround and come back, and the Staples Center was lively, not just for the Lakers, but now for the Clippers, how did that make you feel as this announcer for this team for 40 years? I mean, to see the rise up again was had to be something for you.
Well, it didn't affect my job very much. My job was to describe what was happening and as entertaining a manner as possible, because sometimes the games weren't very entertaining on their own mark. But they had two or three years where they looked like, here they come, the Danny Manning era, the Gasell team. But they were all short-lived because the then owner of the team, Donald Sterling, just wouldn't allow the team sustained its success, because he wouldn't pay the guys. But now with Steve Ballmer, this goes back 2013 or so. So we're talking about a 10-year run. And in that 10 years, the Clippers have one of the best records of any team in the NBA, in the top three or top four records in the entire league. But people still, you know, harbor back to the old days when they were like the laughingstock of the league. Well, they are no longer that. This is a really solid franchise with a great ownership, great front office, terrific coach, and now four future Hall of Fame players in their starting lineup, all of which, coincidentally, are from Southern California, from the LA area. So it should be a win-win deal.
And the next year, moving into the new arena, I mean, it seems like that's another reason to try to go for it, because you want to build momentum going into that arena, which is going to bring the Clippers more revenue, stream opportunities, you know, and keep them in the upper echelon of going for a title year in and year out.
Well, it's going to be the finest arena in the league, bar none. I mean, nobody's going to be able to come close to that. It's going to make the old Staples Center, now the Crypto.com Arena, look by comparison. So, you got to have a team to take in there. So that's why this is such a daring, bold move. If it works and the team, say, gets the NBA Finals at least and gives itself a chance to win the championship, then you'd go into the new building with a head of steam. If it fails, and if Harden, Leonard, and George all decide to leave as free agents, you know, you're going in there in a total rebuild, which would be pretty much a disaster. So it's a really interesting roll of the dice. I can't wait to see how it works out. One thing for sure, I think the LA Clippers are right now the most interesting team in the NBA.
Oh, no doubt about that, Ralph. You're 100%. So, I mean, being in the NBA, I was in the NBA, was it, with the Nets for 28 years, you 40. I mean, we've seen the incredible growth, you know, of the league since that time, you know, from the early 80s on. It's really hard to believe how we look at the NBA today. And back in when I first started, you know, we had some games on cable, some games on over the air.
Yeah.
Now that's, I mean, so many games are on national television. Games, the final games are on tape delay. And it's amazing the growth of the NBA, and it's obviously a credit to David Stern, who was obviously a guiding light in getting the NBA to be the worldwide sport that it is today.
I'm glad you mentioned that, Lou, because I don't think that David Stern gets the credit today that really is due to him. He helped turn this league upside down. He saw the potential of super teams, super players, and their value, and how to make the sport just jump out of the sports pages and off the TV set. And he just had a vision that none of his predecessors have. And it's a man that deserves a great deal of credit, for sure.
He might be an underrated Hall of Famer when you think about it.
Yeah.
He really is. He went through some dark times. Obviously, I was with the Nets when Michael Ray Richardson was expelled from the NBA for life for the second drug situation. I could still remember him coming down the hallway of towards our locker room, then towards the press room that day that he had to suspend Michael Ray for life, which was a tough, you know, a tough thing. But again, he just was able to continue moving forward with the league, and obviously internationally with the Dream Team. There's 125 players internationally born in the NBA this year. I mean, he really had vision.
Rob,
he did a lot. Last time I saw David was at my Hall of Fame induction in 2019, just a year or so before we lost him prematurely. He got a big kick out of the fact that I mentioned in my induction speech that the games I first saw on television were on the old Dumont network.
Yeah.
54 or something. And he and I are probably the only two people in the building that knew what the Dumont network was. But he is missed. He was quite a leader.
Ralph, I see you got.
He definitely was.
Rob, you got some big names in this book, Bingo, 40 Years in the NBA, talking with Ralph Lawler and Lou Terminello. I mean, Bill Walton, Chris Paul, Doc Rivers. About on the David Stearns front, anything in the book that we can look forward to? Any stories about David Stearns while we're on his, while we're talking about him here?
I go through all of the commissioners. There have been five or six. I forgot now without double checking, but I have a chapter on each of the commissioners and their distinct contributions to the success of the league. And it's some of the names are not even known by, you know, present day NBA fans, but the leadership of the commissioner in all sports is very important. But I think they have a fingerprint that is more significant in the NBA than any other, because you've got 30 teams, but you only got, you know, a dozen to 15 players on each team, and you can change the dynamics of a team almost instantaneously when you acquire, you know, a key player. And Stern just had a vision of that. I detail that in the book, along with the contributions of each of the others, including the present-day commissioner.
And, you know, the present-day is now instituting this playing games. We'll see, tournament. I don't know if you have any thoughts on that. Is it going to spice up the league? What do you think is going to happen with that?
I haven't got a clue. I'm not... all excited about it beginning here in a couple of days, I guess now, at this point. But I wasn't too crazy about the idea of the play-in tournament, and it wound up being, I think, a smashing league-wide success, adding interest in markets where the playoffs were but a distant dream. All of a sudden, they got a shot because they were the 10th best team in the conference rather than being in the top eight. So I think it may take a couple of years before it really has meaning. They're regular season games that count just like any other regular season games. And they also apply to this NBA Cup or whatever they're calling it. We'll see how it goes. I'm not excited about it, but I'm interested to see how it works out.
Yes, me too. I'm not excited about it. I mean, I'm trying to do the European soccer type angle here, but you know, we'll see what happens and give it a shot. But Ralph, you talked a little bit a couple of minutes ago about the mid-50s, the Dumont Network. So obviously, I have seen it, and you have seen it also, the evolution of broadcasting in the NBA, you know, over the last 40 years. Is there anything that has that you didn't expect, that has jumped out at you, that was more successful from a broadcasting angle?
Well, a lot of teams used to do simulcast, where you were, the broadcaster was doing both a radio broadcast and a television broadcast. We did some in the 1980s with the Clippers, and I did it even back in the San Diego Clipper days in San Diego. Chick Hearn did it throughout his entire career, 40-plus years with the Los Angeles Lakers. George Blaha and Detroit them for years, and most teams around the league, because it just seemed like it made sense to have one guy do both radio and television rather than hiring two guys and two crews. That's a huge difference, because now you wouldn't dare, I don't think, do a simulcast. I think the National Hockey League has a couple of teams that have gone back to simulcast to save money. I can't imagine that happening in the NBA. I think the league would really frown upon any team trying to do that. But that's the biggest change. You know, the pace of the game has changed up and down and back up again over the course of the years. But it's always been a fast-paced game from the broadcaster's standpoint, as hockey is, as baseball is not. I was watching an NFL game last night, and I told my wife, I said, boy, this is like the perfect game for television, the perfect game for a broadcast, because you've got action and you've got time while they're in the huddle to analyze what just happened, and then you go back to action. The pace is just absolutely perfect. Baseball, you doze, you know, for 10 minutes at a time, and then something bang bang happens. Basketball and hockey are just kind of just nonstop action. You're just got to always be on top of it. I loved the sport as a kid. Loved the NBA. The day it was formed in 1946, I'd seen George Mikan play at DePaul University against the Bradley Braves in Peoria, Illinois. And then he became the game's first great big star. And yep. With Mr. Basketball, I had a chance to meet George Mikan years later. And I just think the one thing, I don't mean to make this a big plug for the book, but the good thing about the book is that I've had a view of this league from day one. I've known all the great stars from Mikan to Bill Russell and the dynamic years with the Boston Celtics. They won 9 championships in the 1960s. Yep. On the whole group of more familiar names to today's NBA fans. And I think that's unique. Not maybe Al McCoy in Phoenix would have a similar view, but I don't know who else in the planet Earth has that kind of a overall, 35,000-foot view of the NBA.
Ralph, would you say L.A.?
You've been blessed.
Yeah.
Ralph, you had mentioned Bradley University.
Yeah.
So you follow Bradley when they played CCNY in the final of the NIT and in the NCAA in the same year, correct?
Yeah, oh, absolutely. I followed them. I had my heart broken twice, yeah. And broken again a year later when almost all the players on both teams were involved in a college basketball betting scandal.
I know, yes. That was not good. Now, you talk about that. I know that you started when the Clippers moved from Buffalo to San Diego, but you also did some games for the Conquistadors, correct?
Well, actually, it wasn't the Conquistadors. It was the team that followed them, the San Diego Sales.
Okay.
And they changed the moniker of the team. And once the new owners found out in the middle of that 1975-76 season that they were not going to be among the ABA teams being absorbed into the NBA, they just pulled the plug and said, screw it, I'm out of here. And I was back.
So you weren't there when Chamberlain was the coach of the Conquistadors?
Yes, I was. I was doing San Diego Charger football games in those years, and was there at the news conference when Wilt was introduced as the player coach, and they emphasized the word player, but then the reserve clause, and the L.A. Lakers said, if you're going to play basketball, you're going to play basketball for us in Los Angeles, and Wilt became a coach, and he had no more interest in coaching than he did in, being in a sewing contest.
Right.
Rob, I got to ask you, thanks so much for doing this today. I got to ask, do you feel like L.A. and Ralph Lawler are a perfect fit? Because your dad actually was head of the movie theater chains. I was reading in your book, and you got to see all the Hollywood stars. Now you're 40 years in Hollywood, and in the game doing the Clippers and whatnot. Is L.A. and Ralph Lawler a fit because of your background, would you say?
Well, I don't know. I just never thought of myself as a big city broadcaster. I'm a small-town boy from Peoria. Started my broadcast career there, then spent 10 years in a small town of Riverside, California, and then San Diego. I got my big break really going to Philadelphia in 1974, and then came back to San Diego, and the team moved itself and me to Los Angeles, and all of a sudden I was a big city boy. Something was interesting. Hollywood Walk of Fame induction, whatever year that was, 2016, I think maybe it was. The star was placed on Vine, right near the corner of Hollywood and Vine. And in 1946, before the Walk of Fame even existed, my dad, who had been a showman, had worked for and wanted owning a series of motion picture theaters, brought us all out to California for a big summer visit from Peoria. And we stood at the corner of Hollywood and Vine, 50 yards away from where I was standing, getting this tremendous honor of having a star in the Hollywood Walk of Fame. I hearkened back for that 70 years earlier. I said I stood at this corner and never ever dreaming that I'd have a day like this. So whether it was preordained or a perfect fit or what, it sure worked out well for me. I love Los Angeles. I was not very happy when the team moved from San Diego to L.A. because San Diegans tend to look at Los Angeles like this big, terrible place. But it's a great city, and it was the one good thing that Donald Sterling, the then owner of the club, did when he made the move in 1984 from San Diego to L.A., just as the San Diego Chargers moved to L.A., and it's been a very solid move for the football Chargers as well. It's a great city and a great sports town. It has two of everything. It's really a fun spot to work.
Ralph, I know you have a great friendship with Bill Walton, and to me, he's as good as any college player I ever saw. You could flip a coin between him and Kareem Abdul-Jabbar.
Yep.
What would have happened if he was healthy to the Clipper franchise? Would they have even moved out of San Diego if he didn't have those foot injuries? I mean, I think if he had been healthy his entire career, I think he would be right up there with top one or two players of all time. He was that good. He was a great passer, a great rebounder. He had the high basketball IQ, great outlet passer. What do you think about if things went a little bit different with his health?
Well, maybe a lot different. Bill feels a great sense of shame. He feels like it is his fault that basketball did not succeed at the pro level in San Diego. Certainly, when Bill was right, he was as good as anybody who's ever played the game. Certainly as good as anybody who's ever played the game. And I think that to directly answer your question, had he been healthy, or even reasonably healthy, the team would have succeeded in San Diego. It would still be in San Diego. There'd be a new arena in San Diego, and it would have changed the whole face of the franchise for sure. And he was so good, they likely would have been a championship team. But it changed the whole
thing. He was a tremendous player. I mean, he did everything well. He really did.
Well, he made people around him better, and that's always kind of been the yardstick that is used to the basketball greatness. Do you improve the play of your teammates? And that's what he was all about.
Well, I've got to,
that is true.
Speaking of teammates, Blake Griffin really changed L.A. Clipper history, I would say. And when he came on the scene in 2009-10, when he was drafted, what was your take early on? And is there a chapter in this book, Bingo, 40 Years of the NBA, about the impact of Blake Griffin on the Clippers' history?
Well, it was significant, that's for darn sure. He was such a great college player at Oklahoma, and he was a consensus number one pick. He came in for his pre-draft interview, and the team at their practice facility invited sponsors and season ticket holders in to watch his workout, which was, there was no question who they were going to take. And so Blake put on an exhibition. He did all this stuff that they wanted him to do, and they said, now, let me do something with two basketballs. And so they gave him two basketballs, and he showed, it was hard to believe, a man 6'9 was handling the ball, or the balls, as well as he did, dribbling his legs behind his back and doing all this stuff. And he was such a sweet, unspoiled young man, got to know his mom and dad, his brother well. And of course, during his rookie season, after he was drafted number one overall, he got hurt in a preseason game and missed his entire rookie season, coming back his next year as an NBA rookie, because he hadn't played an NBA game. He was an easy choice as NBA Rookie of the Year, one of the most athletic slam dunkers I've ever seen. And I broadcast Julius Erving's first game in the NBA after he came over from the NBA to the Philadelphia 76ers. So I saw lots of Julius Erving slam dunks, lots of Dominique Wilkins, the human highlight film, but none of them were any more dramatic or dynamic as Blake Griffin. He was a sight to see and a terrific young guy who, and I do detail this in the book, things kind of went to his head. It seemed that he really changed as fame blossomed. He wound up being a stand-up comic. He wound up being on, seemed like, every TV commercial you'd see during an NBA game. As a TV spokesman for a half dozen different sponsors. And it really changed him. And that was unfortunate. And then he got very, very bitter after getting a big max contract deal from the Clippers. They traded him to Detroit, and it really embittered him. And I had some unpleasant exchanges with him that I hated to go into, but in writing a book, it's not something I had to go into, and I regret that. I still wish Blake well, but I still wish that Blake could have a do-over and be as nice a young man today as he was then, and he's not.
Lou mentioned Bill Walton real fast, and I wanted to know, it seems like you brought him into the broadcast world. So tell us about that, how he became your partner there.
It's a funny story, because Bill and I remained very close after he left the Clippers and went to Boston, where he became sixth man of the year and won a second NBA championship. And then his feet gave out again, and he had to finally, retire. And he went back to San Diego, not having a clue what to do with the rest of his life, because he'd been a basketball player since he was a kid, as long as he could remember. And one day, my then girlfriend, my now wife and forever life partner, and I were at a beach in Pacific Beach in San Diego, and we decided we wanted to get something to drink. So we walked from the beach to this 7-Eleven around the corner. Walk in, and there's Bill standing in line, wanting to get a beer. So we had this reunion, and all excited to see each other in this off chance. And I said, "What are you doing?" He said, "Nothing. I have no idea what to do." He said, "I'm bored. I'm lost. I have no direction, no purpose in life." And it was really pretty sad from this guy who had been the greatest basketball player on earth just a few years earlier. And I said, "Well, have you thought about broadcasting?" Bill had a very bad stutter and stammer problem since childhood. And one of the reasons that he had difficulty dealing with the media over the years, because he just had difficulty expressing himself. And so my suggesting to him that he get into broadcasting seemed pretty strange to him. But he wound up doing some work with a therapist and got to the point where he could express himself. And he went the minor leagues for the NBA in those days was called the CBA, the Continental Basketball Association. He went there and broadcast their games for free, offered his services for free, just to get a feel for what it was like. And he kind of liked it, thought it was fun. And we had an opening. I think we did like 35 games on television in those days over the air. This is early 90s. And brought Bill in. And he was an absolute sensation. Our game, when NBA League Pass started, whatever year that was, became like one of the most watched games in the entire league, because Bill helped make every single game a delight to hear. You loved him or you hated him, kind of like the Howard Cosell phenomenon of some years earlier. And we had more darn fun for 13 years, and our close friendship became a bond for life.
No, that's sensational. He's terrific on the air, I mean, to this day. And obviously, you were great on the air. So the chemistry was there. And you worked with a lot of good analysts. Was there any particular broadcaster growing up that you admired?
Well, I was really, really lucky growing up in Peoria, Illinois, because it started that Peoria's Bradley basketball was really big. You mentioned the CCNY finals, the NIT, and the NCAA tournament 1950. But it was the big social event in the city of Peoria, a town of about 100,000 in central Illinois. And so there are three different stations in town broadcast the games at the same time. They didn't give the rights to one team. There were three teams, three stations that carried the games. Chick Hearn broadcast on the NBC affiliate. Tom Kelly, who had a great career in Los Angeles, primarily as the USC football and basketball broadcaster, another. And then Hank Fisher was another. And at one time, Bill King, who wound up becoming a famous football, basketball, and baseball broadcaster in the San Francisco Bay Area, was also in that mix. Before that, a guy named Jack Quinlan and Jack Brickhouse went from...
Oh, my God, what a bunch of great announcers.
They went from Peoria to Chicago, and then Chick in the late 50s led the parade to the West Coast. Kelly followed, I followed, Bob Starr followed. So I had all these guys to listen to, and I'd listen to them every single road game. We attended all the home games, and it was like a broadcast laboratory that I grew up in, and I tried to emulate them all. I would play, board games, and I'd broadcast the games as I was playing them. And so I was really fortunate. I'm talking about some truly great broadcasters that I had a chance to listen to from the age of 7 or 8, on up through my high school and my college years at Bradley. And there's no question that it had tremendous influence on me, and was a very positive learning experience for me as a broadcaster. And I love the art. I love the craft of broadcasting. And so we had a season. We won 12 and lost 70. And I enjoyed every one of those 82 games, every single one of them, because I love the craft. My wife, after a game, would be all upset because the Clippers had lost. And I'd be feeling great because we had a really good radio broadcast or telecast. I said, oh, man, we did great tonight. And I'm a lucky man to have had a 60-year career in broadcasting, 40 with one team. I just can't believe how lucky I've been.
Ralph, I got to say, as someone who did play-by-play in college, and I just love doing play-by-play, I could feel the same spirit that you're talking about right now. But did you ever go to the games before you got into the business and actually tape yourself as a kid when you were at the arena? Did you ever do that? Did you ever do those type of things where you record in the arena doing it by yourself and then maybe making a tape out of that?
I did that in high school and college at Bradley games. Dad was a pretty good booster of the program, and they gave me a seat high up into the stands where I could sit with a big old bulky console tape recorder and a microphone, and I would broadcast the games as seriously as if I were in the big time. And then we'd go home, and Dad, who we mentioned here, was a showman. He had a pretty good ear and a pretty good eye. He'd listen and critique my work, and they required a great deal of critique, believe me. But I did, and it was fun. It was just... Once I did it, once I heard my voice come out of a speaker, I was kind of hooked. I was going to be a broadcaster.
Well, Ralph, we can't let you go without asking you, how'd you come up with Lawler's Law? Which, when I would, like I said, I would be watching you guys when I would come home from a long day at with the Nets, and then we were in the office, and then we had a game that night. I get home around 10:30. I pop on League Pass, and I stayed up until you got to Lawler's Law. How'd you come up with that? And for people who are listening, Lawler's Law is?
Well, first team to score 100 points wins. It's the law. And like so many good things in life, I stole it. I'm working in Philadelphia, a then famous team basketball trainer named Al Domenico was the team's trainer.
Yes.
And in the 1970s, it was a very high-scoring league. And Al used to say, I was doing the 76er home games on television those days, say, you watch, Ralph, first team wins 100. First team that gets 100 wins the game. Just watch it. Happens every single night. Just watch it. And so I started watching it, and it seemed like I did. And when I got the job in San Diego with the Clippers in 78, I was going to be a full-time team broadcaster for the first time. You're going to be the literal voice of the franchise. I thought, I need to come up with something here that's going to work. And I thought about this first 100 wins thing, and I kind of liked the alliteration of Lawler's Law, so I threw it out there. Clippers scored 100 points. Well, the first test of Lawler's Law, first 200 wins, it's the law. And almost instantly, I started getting feedback. Pretty soon, players and coaches around the league, as well as fans, were spouting Lawler's Law. I'd go up to play Portland. Terry Stotts was the coach, and I first see Terry before our pregame meeting. He said, we took care of your law last night. Big deal. I know even today I'll occasionally see on League Pass, one of the local play-by-play guys will cite Lawler's Law as a kind remembrance, and it always makes me feel good whenever I see that that has outlived me.
Isn't it statistically proven that I think 92% of the time or 93% of the time the team that does hit 100 first wins the game? Yeah, so that's pretty good.
Yeah, I did a recent interview with somebody that there's still a website that tracks this. I've forgotten what it was called, but where they still track it dating back many, many years, including last night's games. How accurate it is, and it is 90-some percent, which is silly. It's not really a law. I would occasionally have fans get kind of PO'd at me when it didn't work. The law got broken, like I did something wrong, you know. This is just for fun. This isn't really a law.
Well, you know, the whole thing about the scores and everything has become a thing with the gambling. We get into that on another day, but it's just been crazy how much that's taken off in the sport. Real fast though, League Pass has put you coast to coast now in a sense. So what does that mean when they invented it, and have you seen a difference of East Coast respondents as well for your work in LA?
Well, we're certainly going to recognize more. I mean, before League Pass, nobody ever watched a Clipper game, outside of Southern California, Nevada, Hawaii. The games are limited to that region by the regional sports net. All of a sudden, you'd go to Cleveland, and somebody would cite Lawler's Law, or they'd yell bingo, and I'd walk into the building, and I'd go, wow. And especially during the years with Bill Walton, people would want to talk about something Bill and I had gotten into on a previous broadcast, and knowing Bill, it could have been anything, basketball or who knows what, maybe Grateful Dead related. It definitely changed our stature. I always thought it was a situation where the local broadcasters, once they went nationwide and the games were on VA TV, very often should have gotten compensated in some way or other, because NBA TV would come and over to the press table before a game and ask me to do a game open for them, and they would promote. Tomorrow night, Clippers and the Cavaliers on NBA TV at 7 p.m. and
right,
play our entire broadcast, and nobody ever gave anybody an extra penny, and that always seemed a little bit wrong. I'm not in the sour grapes, because I haven't got one regret about my career, and certainly never was concerned about not making enough money. I was well compensated for all those years, but it just seemed like it wasn't quite fair that they were using a broadcast. Now, I don't just mean the announcers, but the producers and the originator. There should have been some compensation for that, and that there hasn't been, which I think is still wrong.
Ralph, you obviously chose this moment to write this book, so why now, and why are people calling it the Encyclopedia of the NBA? I mean, Julius Erving slam dunks is enough of a reason, but any other stories you want to share?
Well, it's 300 and some pages of stories of my life, but moreover, I think the most interesting, two things I think are interesting. One, I think it's a roadmap for a career. Because, as I mentioned earlier, I was so lucky to have a 60-year career in broadcasting and then to have one job for the final 40 years of my career. Never could have dreamed of having that happen. But there were some pitfalls along the way, and there were some angels in my life and mentors who helped make that happen. So I think for any young person who's trying to find their path along life's way, and it can be a difficult path, I think this can help give you a little bit of a roadmap of making this happen, because I would wish for anybody that they could have the joy and the rewards of career that I had in mind. I tried to put that down in black and white. I think did a pretty good job of that. The other thing is, this goes back to my mentioning having watched the league since it began. People often ask, what's the best five players you ever saw? Well, what's your all-time all-star team? I think it's almost impossible to compare Bill Russell of the Boston Celtics, all his championships, to Jokic in Denver, or Embiid in Philadelphia, for example, today, because the game is so different. The rules are different. Going back to the court is different. You've gone from a 6-foot wide lane to a 12-foot to a 16-foot. And so what I did, I broke it down. The pre-shot clock era from 46 to 53, the five best players and teams in that era, and then the rest of the 50s, the best players in that era, and then the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, 2000, 2010s, and looking ahead to the 20s. I don't think I've ever seen it broken down quite like that, but I think it just makes absolute sense, because then you have players competing against each other in the same rules, the same era, against each other, and you can, I think, more fairly evaluate, their merits. And so that chapter is an interesting chapter that I think will make a lot of people say, oh, no, you forgot about so-and-so.
Like they did with the NBA 100 list for the 75th anniversary. I remember that debate was raging on forever. I mean, that was crazy.
Absolutely. I mean, fans love to debate that stuff. And so it's all there. It's the book is fun. And it was an interesting experience. Writing it, thinking about things that I hadn't thought about in years. I had a young fellow named Chris Hefting who helped lead me through this. We would talk for hours on the telephone, and he would say, now we need more of that. Give me more of that. Probably not. Forget about that. And we wound up finding a structure for the book that that made sense, and finally made it to the publishing house, and I'm very grateful for it, and I found it a fascinating experience. I got a couple of more in my head that I'm working on, and I think I think myself more now as a rising young author rather than I do as a fading old broadcaster.
well, Ralph, the book is available at Amazon, Barnes & Noble, all the usual haunts.
Yes, it is. It's very, very easy to get. Amazon's probably the easiest way to do it. But we live in Bend, Oregon now, and I had a friend the other day say, I just went to Barnes & Noble, and they got three copies of your book. I said, when did you buy them? But, So they're out there.
Yes. Well, thank you for this opportunity for Alex and I to speak with you. You're an NBA legend, a Hall of Famer, brilliant broadcaster. You are the Los Angeles Clippers, and I can't thank you enough for the opportunity to speak with you today.
Well, Alex and Lou, it's been my pleasure. It's been a fun conversation. I really appreciate you reaching out to us.
And as a youngster in this whole thing, I'm just glad to listen to two minds of basketball going at it today. This was exciting, and thanks for both of you for joining my podcast, and Ralph, for joining Terminello's Take. That was Ralph Lawler, the Clippers legendary broadcaster. Thanks so much for joining us, and bingo, 40 years of the NBA is the title of the book. Thank you so much.
Thank you.